Greetings, Eric Bakker from New Zealand, a naturopath all the way down from New Zealand. Thanks for coming back and looking at my videos today. It's a nice wet rainy day out there and a good day to do some videos. I've got a question here from a lady in the States. And she says, Eric, what causes SIBO? Why is it so hard to treat? She really wants to know that. So this lady sent me an email a while ago and I won't read out the email, it's like this long with like 50 questions on it, which I haven't really got time to answer personally, but I'll do that through a YouTube video. So if we analyse the question, SIBO, what causes it and why is it so hard to treat? I've done some YouTube videos on SIBO, or small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. A long time ago when I was a student, we called it dysbiosis, we didn't call it SIBO. But now we know really that it's a small intestinal bowel problem. And particularly it affects the small bowel. So the small bowel is about 20 feet long. So over three times as long as I am. It's huge. And like any part of the GI tract, it contains bacteria. The stomach doesn't have a lot of bacteria in it because it's quite acid forming and low pH. When we get down to the small bowel, we have got bacteria down there, but they're nowhere near as much as you're going to find in the large intestine, in the colon. So it's estimated that you've got around 1,000 to maybe 2,000 or 3,000 bacteria per milliliter in the small bowel. Now a milliliter is a thousandth of a liter, so it's only a very tiny amount of fluid. So 1,000 to 2,000 bacteria in a milliliter in the small bowel. When we get to the colon or the large intestine, however, we're going to find over 1 billion bacteria per milliliter. So a lot more bacteria in the large bowel. It's a lot more competitive. It's a different kind of environment. But the small intestine is what we're talking about, the small intestine and bacterial overgrowth. Some of the research I've looked at says that SIBO can be caused from some bacteria in the large intestine coming back into the small bowel and overgrowing. Other research I looked at say it's primarily a lifestyle, particularly of the Western world kind of a problem. So what causes it? It's difficult to work out, but antibiotics are a prime cause of SIBO. But so is stress, and so is irritable bowel syndrome and Crohn's disease. The oral contraceptive pill is also linked with small intestinal bacterial problems. There are many medications. Proton pump inhibitor drugs or acid blockers can be linked up with it. So there are a myriad of drugs that are linked with it. Stress is one of the big ones. But it's also estimated that about 6 to 15% of healthy people are asymptomatic, meaning they haven't really got symptoms, but they also have SIBO. And it's also estimated that 80 to 90% of people with irritable bowel syndrome have got SIBO. So what are the symptoms? Well, cramping, pains, bloating, gas, diarrhea, a lot of abdominal discomfort, can be multiple bowel motions or even only a bowel motion every 2 or 3 days. But generally, it will mean bloating and abdominal discomfort will be a prime one that you're going to get with it. Why is it so hard to treat? Well, if you think about it, it's right in the middle of the body. It's a difficult part to get, access to. So we can take medications in. For example, one of the prime drugs that are used for it is called Rifaxamin. It's an antibiotic. But one study I looked at, a very prominent study, said that about half the people who take Rifaxamin, even more, 60%, get no result with it at all, just aggravation. And also research has shown that you're going to get a slightly better outcome with an antimicrobial, natural one, than you are with Rifaxamin. But the problem with Rifaxamin is it really can create a lot of discomfort and pain and sickness with a lot of people. It can have a lot of side effects. So it is a transient drug. It doesn't stay in the body. It moves through and it causes inaction on killing the bacteria. But I really don't like Rifaxamin. I know there are some SIBO doctors and SIBO experts that love Rifaxamin, but I've had too many patients contact me that feel really bad after taking it. And I see too much collateral damage with that product. I don't really like it. So what do I recommend? Well, I recommend natural antimicrobial. I'm going to recommend a broad spectrum natural antimicrobial. I find it far more effective than Rifaxamin. We'll talk about that in a minute. The other thing with SIBO I should tell you is these bacteria can cause a lot of problems in your body, these bad bacteria. They're little buggers because they can gobble up B vitamins. They can even eat up your B12 before your own body has access to it, right? Because if you look at B12 comes primarily from meat. You can get it from some natural sources, but it's much harder to get hold of. Now, B12 is very, very important because it's one of the most important B vitamins for the nervous system. It helps to give you a lot of strength and stamina. It helps to mature blood cells. It helps to stop anxiety and depression. It's very, very powerful nervous system boosting vitamin. So when you're low on B12, you can have quite low stamina, low energy. You can be much more prone to mood swings, poor cognitive function. You're also more prone to methylation disorders, which is a complicated biochemical cycle. So if you have a methylation disorder, you can be more prone to Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, dementias, cancers, heart disease, many different types of diseases by having a poor methylation cycle. B12 is also required for detoxification of many different types of toxins from the body. These bacteria can also interfere with bile acids. Now, bile acids are very important because they allow a proper breakdown of fat-soluble vitamins for us to absorb them and access them, vitamins A, D, E, and K. So if you've got a lot of these bad bacteria, you can actually have deficiencies of vitamin A, deficiencies of vitamin D, vitamin K, and vitamin E. Bad news. There's also bacteria that can gobble up iron, the bad ones, and that can make you really exhausted and tired. Give you a lot of anemia and a lot of immune dysfunction. So you need a very healthy, viable gut to have very good health. And you need to do so by making sure you've got a good balance of the right kind of bacteria in the small bowel and to keep the bad ones suppressed. Lactobacillus love the small intestine. Bifidobacteria predominate in the colon, the large intestine. So stool testing will often show the levels of lactobacillus, that we find in the small bowel. I don't want to blow my own trumpet, but I know that Canzina Remove, the supplement I created about 5 years ago now, has been used by a lot of people with SIBO to great effect. And also a lot of these people include people who've used Rifaxamin with no luck at all. And when they used Canzina Remove, they had a good result. Now, why is that so? Well, as I mentioned before, Rifaxamin is only a one-trick pony. It's a one particular drug that has a very narrow band of action in the small bowel. So a study has shown that natural antimicrobials has had a better effect than Rifaxamin, in fact. So why would you use an antibiotic when you can use a natural treatment for SIBO? Canzina Remove, you're going to use 2-3 times a day, for example, one tablet 3 times per day for about 2 or 3 months. And if you use it with a probiotic, a specific one made to work on conditions like SIBO, like Candida Restore, you're going to get an even better outcome. The great thing with these natural antimicrobials is, particularly Candida Remove, it has a broad spectrum action. Okay, so it's not a one-trick pony. It doesn't kill off the beneficial bacteria. We've repeatedly seen this with stool testing. And the third one is the bugs don't seem to become resistant to it. We can take down a lot of these bad bacteria within about a 12-week period. So that's a bit of food for thought with SIBO. It can be hard to treat, but with the right kind of diet and the right kind of treatment, you're going to get a great outcome with SIBO. So I hope that gives you a little bit of an insight into SIBO. What else have we got here? Yeah, so why is it so hard to treat? We talked about that. So don't forget to click on the link in the description below if you haven't got my Candida report. It's quite a good shopping list for you to take with you. It shows you the foods which I really want you to focus on when it comes to improving your body, not just from Candida, but also from SIBO. Thanks for tuning in on the video.